Mary's Flock Monster. I have lived in a small rural town north of the States on the border of Canada for the majority of my life. Growing up, I had a friend named Mary, but her accent changed it to Mary. Ironically enough, her family bred and sold sheep for a living. When we were old enough to wander into the meadows and play with the sheep, we would do so often, keeping her St. Bernards, Gus, and Goliath with us for safety. One early summer morning, a few weeks after the last lambing of the flock was finished, we set out to find and befriend the newest little one hidden away in the small wooded area at the back of her property. The sheep liked their privacy when they were lambing, but typically their privacy was an illusion due to the amount of predators in said woods, waiting for them to single themselves out. We would sometimes find coyote or bobcat victims slaughtered and thrown about the paths. Blood showered everywhere in the struggle. Rarely, the killer would be something larger, probably a cougar, caching the newborn and the mother in trees. We would find it hanging there in a fork of the branches, wedged by its head and its stomach torn open, which massive blood-soaked holes in its throat. On this day in particular, one of the two were still alive. We do not know yet if it was the mother or the lamb, but we knew it was hurt badly. It was bleeding and screaming louder than we have ever heard. The dogs chased after the noise as we followed quickly to the site. I wish we had not. We found at first glance a fresh cougar kill, but something was off. The lamb lay wedged in a fork of limbs like always, dead as a doornail, blood gushing out of it, and a fresh pool flooding the earth below. The mother was also wedged between some limbs, her horns keeping her from shaking loose. Her back legs twisted at odd angles. On her exposed underbelly, just a few days shorn for a cleaner birth, was a deep, precise gash, from her neck to her arse, then a horizontal cut from foreleg to foreleg, with the corners of her shoulder flesh pulled and folded neatly upward, exposing the muscle. The intestines knotted with afterbirth twisted out of her belly up around her neck, still having enough reach to almost touch the ground. The dogs were going fucking haywire when I noticed that there was virtually no blood anywhere else in the entire area. I looked back at the lamb to see its throat had not been punctured, nor was any part of it wounded, but there was fresh blood still gushing out of it. The neck was broken. Hanging abnormally long and swinging eerily from the commotion of the dogs and mother rattling the trees, Mary walked closer to the lamb, trying to see where the blood was coming from. From what we could tell, it was not coming from one place in particular. It was bleeding out of every single pore on its body, out of its ears, eyes, nose, and mouth as well. We stared horrified and confused about how the hell this could possibly happen when we heard distant yelping, snapping us off the attention of the lamb to see Gus and Goliath were gone. In pain somewhere in the distant woods, but not too far to run, so without thinking we followed the noise to see Gus motionless in a bloody pool and Goliath standing over him. Over Goliath, however, was something so horrifying I do not even know how to properly explain it. It was a red-brown scab color, tall, with long arms and huge claws that would compare to that of a bear. It looked starving. The head was like a deer, but longer, like an anteater, with no ears, and a mane like a horse's, but the hair was very thin and ragged. It stood on its hind legs, that bent backwards awkwardly. It had to use the trees for support with one hand, the fingers just as long as the claws on the tips. The hands themselves would resemble a human hand with those origami claws on each finger. It was wheezing out breath as if it had bronchitis or pneumonia. Goliath ran towards it, and using its free hand it grabbed him by the neck, lifting him easily off the ground yelping. The hand clutching the tree slipped off, casually, and the monster tossed its shoulder onto it, leaning on said tree, then ran its claw gently down the dog, caressing it. Stopped just below its neck and plunged the tip of its nail in, the dog screaming horrified as it tore a surgical hole down his belly, then hung him on the limbs as its head shot in our direction, turning to us as its dark hollow eyes narrowed, frozen. We watched it take a step. It wheezed out an ear-piercing wail like a wolf's howl mixed with nailed on a chalkboard, mixed with the pained screams of a rabbit emitted out of its small hole of a mouth. Then I blacked out. I woke up at home with Mary, not knowing what happened. Most of my memory would return later, but what happened after the thing turned towards us would need to be told to me by Mary. Apparently we ran and hit it, chasing us all the way through the woods until we hit the edge, then it stopped. We continued running until we got to her house, crying. We tore open the door to her house and then to her room. Then I fainted on her floor, exhausted. She tried explaining to her parents, but they did not believe the story, said it was a bear or something. Mourned the loss of the dogs, then began building a large fence a few weeks later. It's been a few years, and neither of us know what it was. It did not resemble the behavior or look of a Wendigo or rake very well, but we both remember the experience vividly. I have more stories about this monster. Let me know if you want them. If you use this story, please credit me and Mary. HORROR MULE1, and Mary. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed the video, hit that like button to support my work. And as always, enjoy the fear, my dear.